We will be inviting Mr. Koo Swee Yong, CEO of International Property Advisor Private Limited, to share with us his expert insights on this subject. Prior to running his own practice, he was the Director of Marketing and Business Development at Seville Singapore and the General Manager at Far East Organization's Indonesia office. Mr. Koo's expert opinion has been regularly featured in various newspapers, and he has published 6 books on the property market. He is appointed as an adjunct faculty at SMU, NUS, and Ngee Ann Poly. Let's invite Mr. Koo, please.
Thank you. Hi, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Precepts Group International and EPPL's CPF and Your Retirement Forum 2021. Title of my talk today is Financing Your Home with CPF. Is it really a winning strategy? I'm Koo Swee Yong, CEO of IPA. I run the small boutique property agency where we help investors with buying, selling, leasing their properties, and in some cases also we help them with property and tenant management. Okay, we start with a disclaimer first. Care has been exercised in the calculations and in the provision of the data and the information. However, we are unable to guarantee that it is complete, and information fluctuates day by day, may be subjected to changes without notice. We try our best, but we shall not be held responsible for any negligence through the loss of and use of this information. In any case, I'm not making a sales pitch. There's nothing for you to buy listening to this talk here. Okay, our agenda for today: financing your home with CPF. Is it a winning strategy? Today we will be looking at some things backwards with hindsight. However, we have a chance in a lifetime to do things correctly at 55 years old, when our CPF starts on the retirement account, and then we realize that maybe it's not really enough. And then at 65, when we start to receive our CPF life payouts, and we realize that it is really not enough. This type of hindsight, you cannot learn from it and then try to rewind your life and get back to restarting a new CPF account again to save up for the retirement, because we have only this lifetime. So in Singapore, we are allowed to use monies from our CPF account to buy our residential properties. And so many, many of us have done that. And many young couples today, in order to get onto the real estate train earlier, have actually started straight out of university or out of their polytechnic studies, getting into their first home and already using up their CPF. But is such a strategy really good? Are they able to look forward? So later on, I'll be presenting you some charts. Let's take a look, see how such strategies compare. Okay. First, we start with some data. A recent article by Dollars and Cents reported that the CPF members, active CPF members, 64% of them have actually accumulated sufficient money that they have hit their retirement sum requirement. Now, I read that paragraph. You look at that line that I boxed up in red. 64%, is that a good number? Is the required retirement sum? This required retirement sum also includes not just the cash portion that is in the CPF account, but also the pledged CPF portion, the pledged property portion that is in CPF. So is 64% good? I tried digging a little bit deeper into it by referring to the actual CPF annual report itself, and the number was 63.6% of the 40,000 active CPF members who turned 55 in the year 2020. Now, then that's actually might not be that good a number, because what happens to the other 36%? 36% of the active CPF members who turned 55 last year, that's around 15,000 people, have not got their full retirement sum. So there might be something to worry about. Another data point, a recent product, a mortgage, reverse mortgage product by the DBS, offered for those who have fully paid private residential properties, but who do not have the full retirement sum, they are able to take a loan against their property, such that DBS would loan them up to the amount they would take to top up to their full retirement sum. And then DBS would charge an interest of 2.88% per year. So if DBS did their homework, it must mean that there is a market where there are significant number of homeowners who have got fully paid up private residential properties, but who have yet to top up their CPF account to the maximum. And an example that I would like to give for such a category of people would be a husband and wife couple where there is a homemaker who in the last 30 years of her life may be taking care of the children, bringing up children and making sure that the home is operating smoothly, so she is the CEO at home, but she has not got a regular income and therefore she has not reached the maximum of her CPF, and therefore DBS deemed it sufficient, this pool of people, this market that is available for them to launch this product recently. This was an article in August. Now, two sets of data. Conclusion that I make, a quick one, is a large proportion of Singaporeans actually retire asset rich, cash poor. But when you hit that point where you realize that, hey, I'm asset rich, cash poor, my CPF hasn't reached the maximum amount, or even at the full retirement sum amount, that by the time I reach 55, maybe the monthly cash payout from CPF isn't exactly sufficient for me to stop work totally and enjoy my full retirement. The reason is we have made choices earlier on in our lives that have led us to where we are today. So with hindsight, is this piece of hindsight good, valuable information? We can't really rewind our lives to go back and restart all over, not buy our home with CPF so early and so young, right? So let's learn from a theoretical example, but this example that we are writing up, that we are creating the scenario out of, we have actually seen many young families in this same situation. So although it is a theoretical example and the calculations are based on some of our assumptions, we think that this is a scenario that is playing out across Singapore probably every day. So the scenario being, Mr. and Mrs. Wong are both 30 years old. For the ease of calculations, we made them the same age. They would like to buy a four-room HDB that is priced at $400,000. Could be a BTO, net of grant. It could be a resale HDB at $400,000. Could be new, could be relatively old, depending on location. Their friends, families, and relatives are happy for them. They were married recently. Maybe they are waiting for the first baby to be born, so now they would like to buy a $400,000 four-room flat, a typical Singapore family. But everybody will be contributing their suggestions how they should be paying for this $400,000 HDB flat, their first home. Most of the suggestions, though, would be very short-term. You'll be looking at what's going to happen in the next 3 years, 5 years. What happens if baby wants to get registered for primary one? So for Mr. and Mrs. Wong, after listening to everybody, they are none the wiser because there are too many choices and options. They decided to try to break the tie in all these discussions by thinking very long term. What are our opportunity costs of selecting these various options for paying for our $400,000 HDB flat? Okay. So they have got four options. HDB flat price, $400,000 on the left in the yellow box. Option A, which is the most typical option most young families would be buying into. 10% of the down payment is paid in cash, that's 40,000. Another 20% paid in CPF, that's 80,000. Some younger families, of course, have got that CPF $80,000 coming through from the CPF HDB grants that they are qualified to take. And then they will take a 70% loan to value ratio, LTV for loan to value ratio. And that 70% loan that they take, which is $280,000, they would be paying the monthly payment of about $1,200 using the combined CPF of Mr. and Mrs. Wong. So that's option A. Option A is very typical, but it is really not an option that I would be recommending. Then option B, they still take 70% loan, but they use less CPF. And then they use more cash because they have got a good career and they have got a good bonus this year. They are using 20% cash, so that's $80,000, 10% of the CPF, $40,000. And then they plan to service that 70% loan, $280,000 of it, for the next 25 years by using the monthly CPF contributions that they have to pay for the home loan. A little bit more conservative, option B is good because they are using less CPF upfront. You're allowing more of your CPF to be accumulating and gaining the 2.5% interest and compounding. Option C, a lot more conservative. In fact, I would consider option C very conservative. 70% bank loan with 10% CPF and 20% cash as down payment, the 70% bank loan being paid for by cash. So the $1,200 a month for the next 25 years, they'll be using cash to service. And then option D, which is a little bit more conservative, however, it is still an expense given that option D will be 60% loan, meaning you have got less borrowings, which is good, lower liabilities, makes for faster financial freedom, perhaps. They will use 30% cash, 10% CPF, and the 60% of the borrowing, they would still be using CPF to pay for the monthly payment, which is less than 1,200, but 70% loan to value ratio they use, they'll be paying 1,200 per month for 25 years. At 60% LTV, they are paying around $1,000 a month for the next 25 years. Okay, let's compare what these four options do. Later I'll ask you to give me your opinion. We'll do a short poll to see which one you prefer. So option A, cash 10%, 40,000, CPF 20%, that's 80,000, and then borrowing 280,000, and with the full 280,000 borrowing repaid over 25 years using CPF. This is what the graph looks like. The blue line shows Mr. and Mrs. Wong from the age of 30, withdrawing $80,000, and then they repay monthly over the next 25 years such that by the time they reach age 55, they have finished paying for the loan, but by the time they reach age 55, the initial drawdown on CPF was $80,000 for the deposit, and then monthly they pay $1,200. So in combination, by the time they reach 55, both husband and wife have paid about $450,000 using their CPF. But if they did not withdraw the CPF, and this blue line didn't happen, they continued to keep that $1,200 a month of mortgage servicing payments in the CPF, it would have compounded. They would have kept the 80,000 of down payment, they would have kept the monthly 1,200. That would have compounded into about 650,000. The foregone interest in this 25 years of loan payment for the home ownership, the foregone interest is 206,000. So Mr. and Mrs. Wong are short of the 206,000 that the CPF board had been happily, willingly given to them over this 25 years period, but they chose to forego it because of the need to buy the home as well as service the payments by CPF. So that's option A. Option B, a little bit more conservative, using less CPF upfront for the down payment, more cash, 20%, and still taking a 70% loan, and this 70% loan being serviced by CPF. So we replotted the graph. At 30 years old, you start with a $40,000 withdrawal of CPF, and then you paid the $1,200 per month for the next 25 years. By the time Mr. and Mrs. Wong are 55 years old, they would have paid about $430,000 using their CPF funds. And if they hadn't withdrawn this money in that 25 years, they would have a CPF account that would have almost $600,000. The interest foregone in these 25 years is $172,000. That's still substantial, despite the fact that we started off a little bit more conservative, using less CPF money from day one. But you still, Mr. and Mrs. Wong still had to forego $172,000. Now, option C, the most conservative, because this option, Mr. and Mrs. Wong recognizes that CPF is actually a good savings bank for their retirement. So they use 20% cash, $80,000. They use 10% CPF, $40,000 as the down payment. But the 70% of money that they borrowed from the bank, they paid by cash. And so the $1,200 of cash payment every month comes from their own savings, from their salary, from their take-home pay. This is what the graph looks like. At the initial purchase, you took out $40,000 from your CPF. Across the next 25 years, you did not use CPF to pay down the loan. So the rest of your CPF would be accumulating more and more earnings, because every year the 2.5% would compound. And still, at the end of 25 years, your foregone interest is $34,000. So you started with withdrawing $40,000 from CPF. That $40,000 withdrawal from CPF could, in fact, also be the HDB CPF grant of $40,000. It's paid through your CPF to help you defray the upfront cost of purchase of the HDB flat. But still, after 25 years, the foregone interest on that $40,000 is $34,000. It's not a small sum, especially depending on the circumstances when they reach 55 years old. Now, option D, recognizing that they might be able to be prudent at the front by using more cash, maybe there's additional family support, there's ang paos from relatives from their wedding, they use 30% cash, they have 10% CPF down payment, and then they borrowed less from the bank to reduce the liability that both of them would carry. So 60% bank loan. What happens? At 30 years old, they withdrew $40,000 from CPF, but every month they are paying the bank loan. Over 25 years, they would be paying a total of $350,000 to $360,000 out of their CPF. And over these 25 years, the interest foregone is still a relatively hefty $152,000. This is interest that they would have earned if they have kept all their money with CPF. Okay, this is option D. So let's sum it up. Out of the four options, if you could just perhaps take out your mobile phone, take a screenshot of this screen, the survey link is there, it's a tiny URL with CPF and home. Which option would you prefer? Okay, we can still think about it. I'll be flashing up this slide again towards the end of this half-hour talk, and then you might be able to think through again. Now, let's continue this story of Mr. and Mrs. Wong. Many young couples, while their careers are doing well, babies are coming along the way, they need a bigger space, they have got a bright outlook about their future, they chose option A, and they believe that housing prices will always go up. So for Mr. and Mrs. Wong, it turned out that their HDB flat price did increase. And so 10 years from owning their HDB flat, they sold it at $600,000 and they upgraded to a $1.5 million private apartment. And they financed the private apartment using $150,000 of cash and $300,000 of CPF. Again, cash 10%, CPF 20%, and the rest 70% loans. So they took out $80,000 at age 30 from their CPF account. At age 40, they managed to sell their HDB flat at $600,000. In that 10 years, having paid the monthly loans using their CPF monies, they still had an interest foregone of $40,500. Now, of course, when they sold the HDB flat, they have got to top up this difference in the interest that is foregone. But since their careers are doing well, they also have sufficient cash and as well as amass additional CPF on the side. They could use the profits as well as they could take on the next loan, because at 40 years old, you can still avail yourself to a 25-year home loan to purchase your $1.5 million private property. So they're upgrading, and many families look forward to this upgrading. They're upgrading their careers, they are looking better, getting a bigger car, children are doing well in school, they also want to upgrade their premises. So this is in summary. After 25 years, this is in summary, top right-hand corner, when they were 40, they decided to upgrade by selling their HDB flat at $600,000, and then they upgraded to a $1.5 million home. However, when they reached 65 years old, that's 25 years later from when they were 40 and upgraded, right? And by that time, they would have finished paying the home loan. The loan was $1.05 million. And they continued to use this method of investment, and now they are retired, having fully paid their home loan using their CPF monies from their salaries, as well as perhaps by then they would also have inherited some money. What is the CPF interest that they would have given up? That means CPF wanted to pay them the money, but they didn't want to take it. If this trajectory continued through the upgrading, how much CPF interest would you think they have lost? So my question is it really an upgrading? The interest foregone in the first 10 years would have been $40,500, just now I showed you on the chart. The interest foregone for paying down the other $1+ million of debt in the private property with is $773,000. So the total interest foregone for this long journey of 35 years of home ownership, they have decided to forego $814,000 worth of interest from the CPF payout. Of course, this is a little bit theoretical, because depending on the circumstances, they might have gone upgrading another round, they might have secured even higher bonuses, or maybe their stock options might have paid them off handsomely, and they could have used less CPF to service their next home loan. They might even be in a landed property by the time they are 65 years old. But just using this Mr. and Mrs. Wong example, where they stopped upgrading but merely paid down their home loan at 65 years old, it is a tad too late for regrets when at 65 you realize that you have forgone, you have given up the opportunity to earn the $814,300 of interest from CPF. So is it really upgrading? You're upgrading your physical lifestyle, but your financial lifestyle isn't really upgraded. So what next when they are at 65 years old? And some of us who are at 50, 55, or 65 years old today might be in this situation. When we look back, we might be having some regrets. So at 65, Mr. and Mrs. Wong realized that they are asset rich and cash poor only if the condominium that they bought still holds its value at $1.5 million. And that would be more likely the case if they had bought something that is freehold. If they had bought something that is 99 years in nature, by the time they are at 65 years old, they would have owned the property for 25 years. That property might be left with only about 70 years on its lease. What's the value then? Would it still hold at $1.5 million? And at this time, they realize that they have foregone $800,000 of CPF interest. it was their choice that they made when they were young. And at this time, the CPF life that is being paid out, because their ordinary account may not be at the maximum level, they may be receiving less than $2,000 a month. So should they then sell the condo to downgrade? Now, everybody also has the same thinking. By that time, I can always downgrade. I can encash it. I can monetize it. I can downgrade. How many people are actually downgrading? Look at the property, look at the population tree of Singapore. This is a year 2020 chart, so it's the latest version that we can have. The axis below, the x-axis, is five-year age cohorts. So I put a black line down through the middle of the baby boomer group, where you can see people who are turning 65 years old and getting into retirement and receiving CPF life. That number is increasing very quickly, the baby boomer group. And then if you are thinking about downgrading, all these people in the baby boomer groups, if they are thinking about downgrading, who in the next 10 to 20 years are the people who might be buying properties? People who are upgrading or buying their first flat or buying their first resale flat, in the next 10 to 20 years, it would be the Generation Z that will be buying. In the next 10 to 20 years, the people who are thinking about selling to downgrade are the people who are baby boomers and the Generation X people who are selling. Look at the difference in the heights of the charts. Generation Z population drops off fast, but Generation Z now is between 15 to 19 years old. In 10 to 20 years' time, they are the groups buying their resale flat or moving into private properties, and their numbers are few. Can we make up for those numbers by immigration, by attracting foreign talent who then become PRs and then take on citizenships? Not sure. From my calculations, together with a bunch of very talented students, and we published this research in chapter one of my sixth book, from the year 2021 onwards, for continuous 40 years, there will be more than 50,000 Singapore residents celebrating their 65th birthday. Plus, our estimates also show that from the year around 2030, in fact, the rates, the total number of deaths in Singapore would exceed the total number of births. That's unless we start to become a nation of baby lovers and we start to make more babies. But the demographic data isn't really for advantageous to people who are thinking about the downgrading in the next 10 to 20 years. So many people are realizing this fact, in fact. And so this is another, this is the same story from Dollars and Cents. CPF members who are realizing that they are asset rich, cash poor, and as they approach their retirement, they realize that their CPF ordinary accounts may have been depleted too much and used for paying their residences. They are starting to top up their CPF accounts. So before it's too late, let's start to top up now so that it can continue to earn the 2.5%. So that they can avoid future regrets. So the learning points today, we cannot rewind our lives at 65. Do not maximize your loan. Try to hold, for every $100 of cash reserve, you hold $200 of CPF as reserves for a rainy day. And do not forgo the CPF annual gifts of interest income. My recommendation for purchasing a $100 property is that you first start with sufficient capital to have $60, 30 of which is in CPF, 30 in cash, and take on a bank loan that is a little bit more prudent, only $65 of bank loan. Use less cash, use less CPF, I'm sorry, use less CPF, use more cash, such that you end up with reserves of $15 CPF, $10 cash, and that CPF, it continues to compound at 2.5% interest rate. And the reason why I'm suggesting that we leave more money in CPF, simple. Don't reject the free interest that the government is giving you. For doing nothing, there's no sales charge, there's net of commission, CPF pays 2.5% to you. And it compounds, and the power of compounding is very powerful. In the gig economy, and entrepreneurship, don't forget, businesses can fail, people can sue for bankruptcy, there may be issues with creditors. CPF money is untouchable by creditors. It is guaranteed by the country. So if I would advise my younger self, what would I do? First, build up sufficient financial wealth before thinking about buying properties, because the job market is uncertain. It is a gig economy. There's technological disruptions. Consider renting first while building up finances. Renting may not be more expensive than cost of ownership. Keep 24 months worth of CPF and cash to cover the mortgage in case of emergencies. Always maintain options and choices, so much so you can quit from the job with enough reserves. You might go do 2 years of MBA, do 4 years of PhD research, and then still maintaining your property. And for sake of prudence, go for a smaller home, take a smaller mortgage. And if you are still confused by all these numbers and advice that I've been talking about, you should engage a trustworthy property agent as well as an estate planning specialist and a financial advisor. Talk to them together such that you have got a better, more comprehensive financial plan for your future. Or you could buy a copy of my latest book, Future of Real Estate, or attend some of my courses for the public. Let's keep in touch. For those of you who would like to have this set of presentation material, as well as you would like to vote on which option you prefer, take a photograph of this page. Contact me through the survey link. If you would like a set of this presentation in PDF form, through this link, you can give me your WhatsApp and your email so that I can send the file to you. Thank you very much.